Tim Jobbington.
You know, that's been a parallel. People have always made parallels, and it's sad.
Remington, have you met Chase Rachels?
I have not met Chase Rachels, but I have seen him in the Gaynarchist group.
He's a champion.
He's a champion.
Where is Chase? Derek, can you put him back on? Well, because you hung up on him. All right. Well, we're back on Flaming Freedom. Welcome. Remington, you are coming to Porkfest.
Yes, sir, I am.
All right. And I heard that more people are going to be coming down to the Startup Society Summit at the beginning of July, 1st through 3rd. We're going to have a big, fabulous dance party at our house July 2nd. That's a Saturday night.
Clothing optional.
Clothing not optional. You can't have it.
Oh. you just can't have it.
And we're back with Chase Rachels. Hey.
Yay.
All right. Well, tell us about Asheville.
Asheville, okay. Well, it's the great, perfect little city nestled in the Appalachian Mountains in North Carolina. It's got a lot of outdoor activities to do, beautiful mountains, great culture, any type of food you could dream of, but it's not a huge city, so it's never too crowded or too much traffic. Lush soil, great people, lots of beer. Lots of great weed. I mean, it's just, you can make it into a libertarian paradise if you really wanted to. And that's kind of what we're trying to do.
Yeah. And I visited Asheville just, last month or 2 months ago and got to see the great community there of libertarian people and families. And it was great to see. I hope there's pockets of libertarians in every town. How many people are there in Asheville in the whole town?
In the whole town, it's just under 90,000.
All right, yeah. So there's tons of towns all across the world with 90,000. If they all had a community like yours, I think we would be in the right place.
Oh, yeah, yeah. We'd have a revolution tomorrow if they're all like here.
Yeah, well, I hope that you guys have more events that are like focused outward toward the general liberty community, like bringing them into Asheville and showing them what you have going on there. Like, there's a lot of events up here in New Hampshire.
Yeah, well, it's interesting to me. It seems the Voluntarist Initiative, which is the liberty organization that's down here in Asheville, it seems we're kind of changing gears, less so of an activist organization, if you will, more so just kind of providing a community of volunteers and peaceful parents. And of course, we're still open to having activist events, but I think it's more about just providing that sort of sanctuary for like minds, if you will.
Well, yeah. Well, what do you mean by activism? What was going on before that you've changed pace on?
Well, I was kind of more interested in, you know, doing education and outreach, which I'm still willing to do myself. And back when it was the Blue Ridge Liberty Project, we did a lot more of outreach, you know, sign wavings, going to colleges, talking there, traveling to different cities for liberty events to promote our area. But the current configuration of our group is such that people seem to be more interested in just kind of having a community and the social atmosphere, not so much the outreach and that kind of thing. So it's more of like a community at this point, but it could change. Who knows?
Yeah, well, right on. I think that's the correct approach for what you're trying to do. What I was kind of thinking, like, it doesn't make sense to go around and leave Asheville to promote Asheville. If that makes sense, like, because you want to build a community in your area and have a bunch of libertarian ideas circulating within the area. I think, like, we have the Free Coast Festival out here. That's like an event that's once a year. And it's mainly for the community of the Free Coast, but there are other people that are like, it's a festival where some people who are like self-selected want to come also and experience the community you have there and learn from it.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that would be a really cool thing. I don't know. Do you have like any type of yearly event that you throw for yourselves in the community?
No, not currently. We don't. What we generally do is when a couple or some people want to come down and visit and see what the community is all about, we generally have like a meet and greet. We get a bunch of people together and go out to eat, or we go around the town with them, or we suggest great places to go, or we'll go hiking or whatever else it is. We're basically just kind of introducing them to the actual people in the community. It's more of a personal approach, if you will. And that's kind of how it's worked. And probably that's probably the most attractive thing about TBI is it's much more personal. And also the peaceful parenting aspect, how family oriented it is. Not to say that single people don't feel at home here too. They do as well. It's great. So it's more about just that personal community feeling as opposed to what you might see in New Hampshire, which seems to be a lot more kind of getting out there on the streets and activism and stuff, which is great. I applaud that. And also we like to do the agorist thing here as well.
Well, I would say that the Free Coast is much more like Asheville than the center or the west side of New Hampshire. They're very community focused. There's a lot of families, and they don't do a lot of outward outreach or activism to people, but they're really all about building the community and just having a space for the kids to grow and the people to grow where there isn't a lot of coercive elements.
Sure.
And that's really great. I love it. I felt so welcome coming into Asheville. It was exactly like you just said, a bunch of peaceful, like freedom-loving people welcoming us. It was us and another couple, I guess, that were visiting in town, and so many people came out, and they were all really fun and nice, and I felt very loved, and it was great.
Thank you. Absolutely. And not even just people in the TBI, but what I like about this area is just the culture that exists here itself, even outside our organization, is very positive, friendly, willing to think outside the box, not chained to what's considered the orthodoxy. So that's why I thought this particular community or area especially would be most conducive to what we're trying to set up here.
And then back to your book. It touches on some complex topics that tries to make them simple. Are those topics generally economics? Is it?
Oh, no, not necessarily, but there are ethical issues. There are economic issues and philosophical issues. And it blends all of these in the book. It addresses all of these different perspectives and angles. And I wouldn't say necessarily, because in some topics, they're just inherently, they're just not simple. There's just not a simple explanation. But what it does do is it brings down the explanations to the point to where any layman can comprehend it. They can go through it, they can understand it. And it's a pretty thorough explanation, but it's also very concise. It's trying to be just all very much meat, not much fluff, just getting down to the pertinent, significant details in the arguments, and also addressing the most common and sophisticated objections.
Well, it kind of reminds me of a book by Ron Paul, which is all about, it's like a bunch of different chapters about different political topics.
Oh, Liberty Defined? Is that what you're talking
Liberty
about?
Defined. It kind of reminds me of that, except it's a bunch of different issues that where Ron Paul kind of takes like the really easy ones.
Sure, softball ones, yeah.
Yeah, he's got like the base covered, and then...
Wait, see, I would consider that like more of a kindergarten book. This definitely is more rigorous, and it's taking less of the softball ones, and more of the more difficult objections to address.
Yeah, it's fun. It's a lot of the relevant issues people are talking about in the libertarian world right now.
Exactly. I think the closest approximation, if you had to make one, would be Rothbard's For a New Liberty.
Oh, what a beautiful book. Well, we're about to go to the break. It's great to have you on. You can stick around if you like and talk some more, and
yeah,
we'll be right back.
You.
My name is Jacob Hornberger. I'm president of the Future of Freedom
Hornberger.
Foundation, which Congressman Ron Paul awarded for having an outstanding freedom website. Write us at
FFF.org,
and we'll send you a free 3-month subscription
to our monthly
book journal
on Audible
of libertarian
already.
Essays and our booklet, Economic Liberty
awesome.
In the Constitution.
So you said you guys are giving it away or something?
Say what?
On the show? Did you say something about, like, Derek said something about you guys are, like, giving it away or something on the show? Or
Derek, are we giving away a copy of the book? Yeah. What kind of? We have a physical copy. All right. Yeah, we're giving away a physical copy of the book. Audio copy of the book for whoever wins the. I'm guessing the quiz show. Usually, it's Derek J's stickers that you win. So, the lucky contestant tonight get a real prize.
Stickers are a real prize.
Stickers aren't a real prize, but because they're just, you know, you can get them. They're free. They're just like stickers just arrive at our house. People are just mailing us stickers all the time. Like, guys, stick this on stuff, please. Stick it.
Like, I thought you said Snickers at first.
Like, oh man, if Snickers were just being mailed to my house all the time, I wouldn't fit in this dress.
Well, in addition to my stickers, I got Derek J's victimless crime spree too. So I guess it wasn't all a loss.
All right, yeah. You get to see Derek in his twink days.
Oh well.
Is he not a twink anymore?
No, he is. But he's more muscular and buff now. He's been doing a lot of sweaty yoga.
Oh, awesome! That's great.
Yeah.
So we're gonna try to get Joe on.
We are trying to get Joe on. He might be coming in at 11. Yeah, 11 o'clock. We're going to have Chase for the first part.
All right. I'm just wondering.
Chase, you learn anything good in school?
No, not much.
Certainly something was exciting or interesting.
Well, I swear, like, I read these books, these technical books, and I read through like 5 pages, right? I'm like, what the hell did I just read? So I read them again, and it's just the same issue. I'm like, what the fuck? it's just such a non-engaging format. And I can pass all the tests with A's so easily because, you know, it's all online courses, so you just kind of look through the book for the answer. So it's just, it's not good for a lazy person to do this because they're not going to learn much.
Well, I can guarantee that, from my experience, the number one way to get really good at technical things is by using the tools to build things.
Oh, I know. And you're absolutely right. And I do need to do that. I think the only reason I'm going to school is because, you know, it's actually paid for. I'm actually one of those dirty voluntarists who take GI Bill money and stuff. So if they weren't paying me to actually go to school, I probably wouldn't be going to school.
Well, hey, school is really good for learning what you don't know. It's like reading books. You're like, oh, there's a lot of information out here, and now I know kind of what I need to learn and use.
Yes, I definitely have learned the magnitude of what I don't know in this field, and it's quite staggering.
but on the other hand, it's completely detached from the market. So like it would probably be better. What I did, the way I ended up getting like really high paying jobs. I just looked on Craigslist for the skills that businesses wanted.
Mm-hmm.
And like, I looked through there every day for months and months and just felt like basically understood all the things that I needed to learn.
Sure.
All right. Well, I think we're coming right back.
Great.
That shows.lrn.fm.
Rachel's author of A Spontaneous Order has spontaneously decided to take your money to spend it on his own education. How do you feel about that, Chase?
Feel great. No, thankfully, I'm not the one doing the taking, but I'll be receiving it. It's there, I guess.
All right. Chase, you used to wear a uniform.
That's right.
So, was it just too much cloth, too covering? You didn't want it anymore?
You know, it's funny. I think my time in the military actually expedited my awakening. I mean, just seeing all the inefficient bureaucracy, the total lack of a threat to individual liberties at home that we're facing from some people living like they're in the third world overseas and then we're going to war with them. I mean, having the kind of strategic perspective I did, being an intelligence analyst, really allowed me to see a sign of the war that most people in the military don't see. They're just doing their one little specific task. They're fixing a part on an airplane, or they're guarding an airstrip. They're not actually seeing what's going on. So I'm kind of thankful in that way for that experience.
Also, you were an analyst. Does that mean you didn't get to hang out in a tent with a bunch of horny, like, jacked up guys all fooling around?
I did in basic. That was kind of interesting. But no, not in...
Oh, do tell.
Well, it wasn't like you might expect in some sort of, like, porno or whatever. It's just definitely not a fun time in basic training. Everyone's just kind of stressed out and not knowing what the hell they're doing, and not really a great atmosphere for anything provocative.
Well, I'm pleased that you're pursuing market-based opportunities for human growth.
But oh,
what I was saying is, when I was learning, on the break, when I was learning to code and get a software job, I always looked at the skills that businesses wanted on Craigslist, like cool companies that I would want to work for. And I just looked for the skills and then started using those tools.
Yeah, that's definitely the way to go. I think that's probably the best way to do it.
Yeah, it seems like most schools, they're so detached from the market because they're really government driven.
Oh yeah.
They probably don't have a lot of the skills you need.
Right. And they don't teach them in a way that's very conducive for you absorbing them, you know? So I really appreciate Code Academy's setup because it's very interactive and you pick up things really quickly with the way they present things, but that's definitely not how you see them in textbooks you have to buy for a public school or whatnot.
A government school.
Right. Government school.
Do we have Remington on the line?
Yes, we do.
Hey, Remington.
Hello, how are you?
Did you go to school? You just learned you were born with your knowledge, that's right?
I went to public school, the state school, but then I, according to Derek G, I rose up. I rose up out of there. But I do not plan on going to any other further schooling.
So are you going to join the military? Chase, do you recommend Remington joins the military?
Definitely not.
you could not drag me into there. Those uniforms don't look good. But I am a journalist, and if I went to journalism school, they would teach me a bunch of things I already know. They don't want to be condescended to. So, yeah.
Well, you guys have seen the Italian police and the Italian military. They have really nice outfits.
Well, they do.
Yeah.
Because Italy is very fashionable.
No, they really do. They're they have all kinds of flair and everything.
And they always look nice. You rarely ever see a fat Italian police officer, at least in the pictures they show.
All right, Chase, what's one hard-hitting thing that you solve in the book? One thing that people don't usually talk about in the libertarian circles?
I'd say environmentalism.
All right, cool.
Yeah.
Yeah, what? Give us an opposite.
Yeah, basically, you know, and I think this is one that a lot of libertarians have an issue dealing with, because it is kind of a tricky issue when it comes to what do you do about pollution and what do you do about waterways, how do you own water, and how do you prevent animal extinction, things like this. So the chapter kind of goes over mostly the economic reasons as to why privatizing all these resources is, in fact, the best way to harmonize our self-interest with preserving the integrity of the environment, and how it optimally balances our needs with the environment's integrity. Because, for instance, if you totally destroy the soil on your land and pollute the hell out of it, well, it's going to lose most of its value in the eyes of most other people. So there's an actual natural incentive not to do this. But for public lands, where you can just, for instance, get government permission to, let's say, cut down the trees for a certain sect of land that's publicly owned, they have absolutely no incentive to maintain any capital value of that land. They can just reap as much as they want as quickly as they can for their allotted time to go. It's the tragedy of the commons issue. So I think that's a really interesting topic that doesn't usually get addressed as thoroughly as it should.
Well, I was in Portland, Oregon, and there was this really cool rose garden, and I think that it was privately funded, this incredible Japanese garden and a rose garden. And I think it was privately funded. Somehow they've figured out a model where they can fund this beautiful thing without money that's stolen, essentially. I think there's a lot of donations by local businesses and things. I would love to see a lot more research into business models for parks and business models for gardens. Because if you can incentivize something with a business model that makes money for the owner, then there's going to be a lot more of whatever that thing is.
Yeah, I gotta tell you, I went to Vegas to visit my father, and I took my son to one of the parks close to his house. It's a private park, and I've never ever seen any other park that. Like how cool, like everything rotated and spun and bounced, like everything was so interactive. It wasn't just this kind of two-dimensional play area like most public parks are. It was so cool. Yeah, government park, that's right. It was so cool and innovative, and the spacing was great. It was phenomenal. It was phenomenal. And the same thing with these inside parks for kids. Like, it's not even a comparison. It's totally out of the league of the standardized government parks that you'll see at these government parks. It's just unbelievable. Yeah,
and I'd like to jump in there. I posted a video on Facebook. Did you see that video, Stephen, about the woman who in Highland Park, Michigan, who the government couldn't even afford to light the streets and such. And she bought lots around her, and she cleared them out and made a safe space for kids to play. And now her plan is to revitalize the area and make it a safe and a nice place for people to go.
Awesome.
Without the government's help.
That's awesome.
Without the mafia. I mean, obviously the mafia is not going to go out of their way to help you out. That's beautiful. So she buys it up and then turns it into something better.
Yes, exactly.
Well, Chase, how about this? Maybe privatizing parks is not necessarily good, or privatizing land. You know, sometimes people destroy the land that they own anyway. Like,
right.
It's not always that, like, the mafia does things worse than another group. Sometimes another group does things even worse than the mafia.
Well, and that's the beautiful thing about the market, is that those who acquire resources and transform them in ways such that their values decrease, like, for instance, they buy a big spot of land for X amount of money and totally trash it. It's worth nothing now. And when they're going to try to sell it, they don't have much more money. So those who tend to increase the value of their items, of their products, whether it's by running a business or by maintaining their land, those who increase value things generally tend to wield ever more resources because they're making more money, which they can find more resources with. Those who tend to be more destructive of their goods, of their land, of their businesses, they tend to lose money and lose control of more resources. So that's kind of where the market regulates who gets what and how much.
Well,
because the productive people get more and the destructive people get less.
That is, if people want nicer and more nature. You know, if people actually want the death and destruction of the environment, then more funds will go to that. So what can you do as a normal person? Spend more money on private parks. Put your resources toward those things, private parks, and there will be more of them.
Absolutely.
All right, we're going to break. Bye, Chase. Love you. Come
you
on
too.
Anytime.
Thank you.
Peace. It was a great pleasure having you. That's a spontaneous order. Christopher Chase Rachels.
On Free Talk Live, we're bringing people to the ideas of liberty every day. From wrestling superstars like Elon Jacobs.
You guys really are having an impact.
Harry.
Like I said,
hello there.
A lot of where I am now is due to listening to
Free Talk Live.
You changed my mind.
You're very welcome.
On some very important issues.
Yeah, as you can see, I don't know if you can see the video, but you are right here in this chair.
I'm not here to your show, but
I am.
Saturday night,
yes,
I'm there.
I'm
on
to
the Free Talk Live project.
Derek running the show. He is coordinating everything. He has 7 laptops open, and he's flying back and forth, and he's picking up the phone, and he's getting Joe on.
Bless his heart.
He's coordinating the green screen. He's phone banking for Rand Paul at the same time.
And Ron Paul's non-existent for like
he's also selling gold to Ron Paul Gold Corporation. He's making cold calls out to people for gold. He is just totally knocking it out of the park.
Is he handing out flyers again for jury nullification? What was it?
It's actually dildos with the jury nullification stamped on the side.
Oh, wonderful.
Yeah, and a QR code for donations.
Oh, amazing. This is the libertarian future right here. That is exactly it.
It's the libertarian present, actually. Did you hear that the drug war is over? Yeah.
It was lost.
Yeah, I'm afraid the war is over. The drug war is over. And the war in the Middle East is over, too. It's done. We're done. We've had enough. It's done. Hey, Joe, are you there?
Yes, I am.
Oh, hey, Joe.
What's up?
Welcome to the show.
Thank you.
Oh,
what are you guys talking about? Stuff's over?
The drug war is over. Yeah, all you have to do is go online to Reddit and search dark markets. And there will be a whole list of websites where you can go and buy anything you want with Bitcoin.
Wow.
And that is some nice thinking, though.
No.
That is not the case.
Remington, this is literally the case. Like,
really?
Yeah. I mean, it's been up ever since the Silk Road. Almost 10 years that this has been around. But it's way more sophisticated now. There's all kinds of markets. But really, go to Reddit and search, or you can even Google it, I don't know, dark markets. And there's a Reddit page with links to all of the best dark markets where you can get any drug you want for Bitcoin.
Lovely.
And there's ratings for the sellers. Really, it is over.
Wow. Amazing. I waited for the sale all my life.
You were a 1 year old and you were like, I want to buy some coca leaves.
It's just like that status caricature of 5 year old prostitutes and druggies.
Well,
they're an addicted 5 year old prostitute. Yeah.
Those exist for sure in the millions. Not kidding though. Like, really? One, slavery is a huge issue in a lot of places, like Brazil. And also, human trafficking in America is a huge issue. There are tons of slaves. It's not good.
There's 300 million.
There are, well, minus the Congress. Yeah, the military, the praetorian class.
So we just can talk about the book, or we can talk about documentary too, Joe.
Whatever you want to talk about, we can lay it all out here. We're going big.
Yeah, we're going big. We're on break, by the way.
Yeah,
that's good.
We'll be back in 3 minutes. Yeah, Remington, you want to take a lead with Joe?
I would love to take a lead with you.
Is it just you two, or is Derek?
Derek is.
Hey, I'm over here.
Oh, hey, what's up?
I'm like pulling knobs and levers and stuff, but I think I'm all ready to go. I'm
you
ready to go.
Hey,
yeah.
You guys, Derek is so handsome tonight.
Oh yeah, I'm wearing a crisp white shirt with a black bow tie, black pants and black blazer. It's all classic Bond here.
And
Shea Liberté.
I gotta tell you, he's been doing so much yoga. His body is so nice. He's got muscles around his core. Yeah. He's
good. Yoga doesn't take farm work, though. Isn't that right, Joe?
Oh, yeah. Actually, Derek, I'm sending you a picture right now. I don't know what you think.
Oh, yeah. We gotta post a sexy picture. No.
Is this something I can share with Unflaming Freedom?
Sure. Why not? If you want to, I don't care.
Loading. Hey. Did you get a tattoo on your chest?
That is some chainmail I've been making.
Chainmail? Yeah. What?
So that piece of chainmail is going to be, we're going to be selling raffle tickets to raffle that piece off.
Wow.
At Orcfest.
Cool.
That's awesome, man. I'll put it in a bid. You're raffling it, or is it for auction?
Raffle.
Okay. So like, I gotta buy my own chances.
Exactly. And then we'll pull the winner at the toga party.
Cool. I want some chain mail that Joe made.
I'll write a hack for the dipole voting machine to use.
Yeah.
Joe, what do you recommend for? Maybe I'll wait. But for togas.
I mean, if you guys are staying in a hotel, right? Just grab one of their sheets.
One of their sheets? I don't want that much cloth. I want to be as scanty as possible.
Well, then go to the a thrift store and cut up a piece of white sheet. I got sheets for like a dollar. Just cut up a piece and wrap it around you in a sexy way.
Okay, cut up a sheet, right?
Yeah, don't use the whole thing.
Sheets are cheap.
Or maybe just a pillowcase.
A pillowcase, huh?
You see, I'm going to have a sheet G-string.
Yeah.
A sheet G-string.
That's good.
Good. Yeah.
No, I'm very modest. You'll see a lot.
That's what you need.
Or you could go with what Dave posted in, I think it was in the Gay-Anarchist group. Apparently, the Greeks used to tie off their foreskin because it was improper to allow the glands to peek out during physical activities. And of course, athletes were naked and everything.
What? They would tie it off.
They would tie it and then tie the other ends to like either the base of the penis so that it was like kind of in a little upward arch. I learned this all today, yeah.
Guess was that's what I have to do.
That's like tucking. You gotta tuck it away.
Yeah, so that's not.
I was wearing this dress today, and I was a little bit worried that my dick was showing too much. But then I realized that that's impossible.
Too much?
Yeah.
It was too little, Stephen.
It wasn't showing enough.
Yes, it was the onion news network. Are we back from break?
We are back from break.
Welcome back, everyone. We are joined by Joe Jarvis from his wonderful illustrious home in Florida.
Oh!
Hey, how's it going? On full plantation home down here.
Plantation home, yeah. He is the author of the book, the newest book in his book series, which is Flight Grounded. Tell us about it a bit, Joe.
So, Flight Grounded is, I guess, I build it as dystopian, but essentially it's another thriller. I kind of write these action sort of thrillers, and obviously government is a main theme, but it's about a guy who wakes up on an airplane, sees some crazy stuff going down, freaks out, starts running, and then he gets blamed for a terrorist attack. And he decides that his best bet is to flee to the Canadian border to try to get this all settled and figure out what's going on so that he doesn't get apprehended by the American authorities who are blaming him for this attack, which he doesn't know who really committed the attack. And I'm explaining this terribly. I probably should have thought about what I was going to say first, but
it sounds great to me. How did you started writing?
So with this one, I was kind of thinking about how little we can verify firsthand. Actually, for instance, a friend of mine was posting today on Facebook about how bad France is getting right now. Like, apparently some really crazy stuff is going down in France, and there's, like, riots every day, and a lot of, turmoil. People are pissed off. And I hadn't heard anything about this. You know, if the media doesn't report it, or if people aren't telling you, then we just know absolutely nothing about it. So that was kind of an example of how little we know about the world. But then even the true things we think we hear from the media, we can't verify them firsthand.
No.
We don't really know if it's happening. And there's all sorts of conspiracies out there about, you know, what is really happening, what's not. But I kind of took that idea and ran with it in terms of what you actually know about the world around you and what could actually be going on if you stretch your imagination enough, you know, what, how bad it could actually be.
Or how good.
Or how good. Well, I mean, in, yeah, I suppose outside of your...
they're starting to have riots down in San Francisco, too. See all those Trumpists getting attacked by mobs?
I haven't seen that. Yeah, I haven't really been paying attention.
Some videos recently. My friend Leah was appalled that I said that maybe if those guys had guns, they wouldn't be attacked so much.
Well, yeah, California, notorious no-gun state, so... either way, they would have had guns, and they would have actually shot someone, and they would have been called racist, and they would have been called bigots, things like that. So it's a double-edged sword.
They would have never shot anyone because they wouldn't be attacked if they had guns. It's like openly displaying a semi-automatic firearm to a bunch of kids with, like, they're not going to attack you if you say you're going to shoot them.
So some of them might. A lot of them crazy people.
They're going to learn pretty fast what happens when you do.
It's just, if the big gang from the government comes and you know, is on their side, that's going to be a problem.
What's the best way to conceal a gun in a toga?
Probably strengthening the anal muscles before you and just go ahead and...
It's always the answer, right?
I would put a little just sew a little pocket into your toga.
Yeah.
Nice. I would think on the inside of the thigh.
Yeah.
You could put a small firearm there. I hope someone has like a Walther PPK I can buy at the Port Fest.
Yeah, that'd be. Hey, do you get to go shooting where you are, Joe?
I shoot in my backyard.
We do the same thing here.
Do you do in Texas?
Yeah, in my backyard, I just pop that out.
You guys are both able to shoot way more than we are, but am I sounding a little quiet?
Yeah, you're quiet.
Oh. I mean, I would love to shoot with Joe sometime.
Yeah?
We all gotta go shooting on July 3rd.
Yeah?
There's Pink Pistols event.
Pink Pistols?
After the Startup Society Summit?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah,
Remington can get some footage of the Pink Pistols thing for our documentary.
Oh, that'd be great.
Yeah. Cool.
Hey, did you hear that there's a gay, or no, not gay, they're French, same thing. There's a media organization that's coming all the way from France. They want to record at Porkfest, and they really want to see people open carrying, which, like, duh, they're going to see that. But
yeah,
they want to see people in town. So I thought it would be cool to get a ton of people, maybe some gays, to walk around in a big mass of people open carrying just for this French news outlet. It would be like,
that'd be cool.
It'd be cool if they could get a shot of like, this is what New Hampshire looks like, and just everyone is walking around with guns on their hips.
I know, making out with guys.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Guys making out with
bathhouses, outdoor bathhouses.
I hope that one steam house is there in Porkfest.
Oh, yeah.
I didn't go into that last year.
I know.
Yeah, did I. Well, we need to get a whole gay anarchist event.
Well, yeah.
We can hold a handful of people.
It holds 10. We need to get 10 people in that steamy area.
They'll probably be like, no, guys, you're not allowed.
Yeah, they're like,
we don't have to clean.
Yeah, I don't know.
We'll bring our own mop.
I'll make sure it isn't too messy.
This is going to be fun.
Yeah, I agree. It'll be the first time that Joe and I get to meet, and I get to meet Joe. It'll be amazing.
Yeah. We've planned all these projects together. We've, like, already collaborated so much and have never met face-to-face. So that'll be cool.
I think it's cool that you took the initiative to make a toga party like you did. That's awesome. You know, like, a lot of events at Porkfest were up in the air this year. We weren't sure, like, what's going on? Big gay dance party? Like, who's organizing all this stuff? It's all uncertain. But you're like, I'm throwing a party. I've got to figure it out.
And that's what, yeah, and I was too lazy to go through with the Porkfest people or try to get a tent and everything. And then that would have, like, stressed me out.
It wouldn't have worked anyway. Yeah, this is true. We tried to find out, like, hey, when is there even a time available for the tent? And instead of just telling us, they said, instead, like, all right, well, let's form a committee around this thing. It's like, no, just like, tell us we can use the tent, and you know, we'll throw a party.
Yeah, they literally were like, hey, you can be a part of the committee, and here's the meeting, and then it was canceled.
Oh, my God.
It's so much bureaucracy. I'm like, I know how to throw a party. Let's just have a tent.
And I decided not even having a tent. So we're just going to have a fire. I'm going to get some torches, make it real. Something about Greece or, like, you know, ancient Greece that really intrigues me. Yeah. So I figured we'd all look very,
we're going to grease up.
You need chisels. You get some chisels. We can chisel at each other.
Whatever you want to do. But we're going to have beer Olympics, too.
What does that entail?
So, first hour, we'll just have some music playing, you know, get into the groove. But then at 8, after we do the drawing for the chainmail, we're going to do two, or how, depending on how many people we have, we're going to start with Elimination Flip Cup, except we're going to vote people off. So, you guys know Flip Cup, right?
I don't.
I've flipped some cups in my day.
You drink your drink, you know, you just pour a little bit in, and then you put your cup on the table and you try to flip it over until it stays flipped over.
It doesn't have any alcohol.
It's beer.
After, you drink it. You drink first. Right. And so then you go down the line. You got like 5 people lined up, and that's your team, and you all, you know, you all flip your cups. So the first team, and the first team that wins... the team that loses has to vote one of their own people off, obviously like the worst person, and then somebody has to drink 2 cups. So that's elimination flip cup. And we're voting people off our own teams so that it's actually the better players that advance.
And then at the end, the 2 winners get to flip cup.
Well, that's always an option, but what we're going to do is once we get down to a couple people maybe on each table, we're going to do beer pong for the final championship.
Yeah.
So, yeah, so...
voting off the person wearing the most clothing.
Oh, I want a big torch.
I am looking into that. Do you have a big torch, by the way, hanging around? I need to get one.
Well, Derek is like a beacon light.
I have many, many torches that I light on fire every night.
It is a strange ritual. It takes like an hour and a half. I'm like, let's go to bed, ready? Light those torches.
So just bring the torches.
Well, yeah, it'll be a fun time. So, Joe, let's talk about our documentary. If you're done with Black Raptors.
All right, sorry about that. We just went to break. I forgot you guys came here.
Informers, informants, agents, provocateurs, guard marks, finks, and similar vermin. Rats was written by OG Libertarian.
All right, well, Rats was a short I want to hear more about the book. Derek just took it away. Oh, well, we gotta wait. We don't wanna blow the load.
It's on Rats.
Well, yeah,
once in a while, you get information that's worth changing your life for. Well, this is one such.
Derek, this is the perfect time to ask you a question.
Yeah.
Can you talk to Ian for us and set up like a time where we can get an interview with him?
Sure. Yeah, we were just hanging out at a cocktail party.
Okay.
It was so cool.
That's cock and tail.
Yeah, there was some of both. I think Steven started out talking about it a little bit. That's why he's wearing a dress tonight. And I was shocked he wasn't the only man wearing a dress.
Really?
So bizarre. Like, in a group of 30 people, you would think he'd be the only one.
Perhaps.
And then another man walks in. You know, it was great. This guy...
So...
Yeah.
No, go ahead. What was the event?
It was just like a friends gathering, you know, getting together in town and socializing. But I was surprised because the person that this I don't know what's it called, this person hasn't. Let's I don't know. It doesn't matter. What were you about to say?
Oh,
I don't want to ruin someone's life.
Yeah, no, that's you left that good point. I'm excited to explore Portsmouth. But is there, like last year, there was like a Keen meetup that Sunday after Porkfest, right? Or something?
Oh, yeah, there's always a Keen meetup every Sunday, Social Sundays. It's one of the longest running Porcupine events.
Nice. Were you gonna go to that, or you're probably heading back to Portsmouth?
No, Portsmouth on Sunday is the Porcupine Pink Pistols shoot. We're gonna shoot.
Oh, right. I forgot. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, and then we're gonna go to Murphy's Tap Room where we can buy everything with Bitcoin.
Am I allowed in there because I'm 18?
Yeah, we'll let you in.
Okay.
Find a way.
I'll wait outside like a little Mexican I am.
Oh, no, it's not like that, New Hampshire. There's a lot of Mexican people. It's not like Texas.
Oh, no, no, what I mean to say is, like, you know, I was about to be very racist, I'll stop. There was a bit of caricature down here of Mexicans, and I'll stop right there. I am one, so I could say it, but...
They wouldn't even know a Mexican if they saw him.
So what are you, from Spain?
Spain. They don't know what
even know
Spain
about
is.
Spain.
Spain is a place in Portugal, right?
Yeah.
Oh, wonderful. How long till we get back from break?
45 seconds.
Okay. Continue. Sorry.
I don't have anything. I'm resting. My rest period. This is a break. I just stare at the camera and look pretty.
Tell us when we have 10, please.
You want me to count you down?
No, just when we have 10 seconds.
Maybe I will, maybe I won't. Don't tell me what to do. Quit telling me what to do. I love that ad. Do you ever hear that on LRN?
I have it. Oh,
that's great.
I can hear the kind of like electronic fuzz.
If you enjoy LRN.fm, you can contribute to your favorite shows via their website. Yeah. Become an amplifier at amp.lrn.fm. That's amp.lrn.fm.
Okay. Going back. So we left off. Remind us, Brendan, you are about to get back into the book.
Yes. The title? It is Flight Grounded. It is about a starts with flight. Is that what I show? Can you get more into the book?
There's a lot of like cliffhangers, and there's a lot of there's like a big reveal, kind of, not a big reveal. I don't know. There's a lot of like kind of twists, and you don't really know what's you don't know what's going on, but it's a clear, you clearly understand what's happening in the book. You don't know behind the scenes.
It's a thriller.
That sounds cool. That's like, it was really fun to write. I mean, did you have fun just like thinking of like, okay, this is what the reader's going to think is happening, and I'm totally going to screw them and do something else? Like,
Yeah. It was definitely fun. Oh, no, it was. I mean, it was probably more fun to write than Anarchy in New England. And I think I was writing it more for the right reasons. Like, you want a book to be entertaining. And I hope that Anarchy in New England was entertaining, but I was definitely trying to introduce people to an anarcho-capitalist society.
Yeah.
And at this one, I'm like, you know, it's a interesting book. Like, it's entertainment. And obviously, I put deeper stuff in there, but first and foremost, it's a nice, entertaining book.
Are there any Easter eggs in there? there are things that you can get into
in certain... on the cover.
On the cover, I know there's an Easter egg because I'm a dummy.
Oh, Joe's Jewish. It's a Hanukkah egg, actually.
Oh, okay.
Who spread those last moment? Actually, everybody should go onto my Facebook page, and you can either look Joe Jarvis or actually joejarvis.me. You can read about the novel there. Actually, you can read the first couple pages of it on the Kindle version on Amazon.
Sweet.
So if you go there, and you can read the first chapter, and you'll be hooked.
So will you have physical copies ready to give out or to sell at Forkfest?
Yeah, sell, Remington.
Yes, sell, excuse me.
No, I'm just kidding. I'll have plenty of physical copies at Forkfest.
I bought my copy last time at Forkfest, and I read it during Forkfest. It was awesome. Anarchy.
I was so excited. Yeah, you came running up to me, and we're excited about it. And I was still in that nervous phase where I didn't know like if the book was good or not, and I got very excited when you came up and told me what you liked about it.
Was that when it just came out?
It was, yeah.
You were just getting feedback for the first time.
Exactly. I have a little bit more confidence now, and this one I am a little bit more confident in at least how entertaining it is.
Well, you've established yourself now. You put a book out, you've done it, now this is number two. The first one of anything, like a director's first movie or whatever. It's always like the culty one that like, only the insiders know about.
Right, exactly.
And now you're like breaking out into the mainstream. You're like, yeah, I'm going for thriller.
Yeah. Hopefully. And it's a relatively short book. You know, it's a quick read. I'm selling it for $7 for the physical copy. So, you know, affordable. There's no reason.
We'll have $8 there.
Well, the equivalent of $7.
We
still express in dollars, Bitcoin. So I don't know.
I'd like to express in terms of ounces. Because silver is the number one currency.
Is it?
At Porkfest, I'd say.
Yeah.
Bitcoin should just be denominated in blowjobs.
Oh, I'd be rich then.
It'll be 7 blowjobs.
It's non-homogenous, though. Because some blowjobs are, like, dry and some are...
Yeah, it really depends on who's giving the blowjob.
Yeah. These are not fungible.
Not fungible. Not a good currency.
You're worth your weight in blowjobs.
In general, it's a good currency.
Your weight in blowjobs. What is that?
My mother's always joking with me, saying I should go to jail just because I love it there. For that, it,
oh, that's she says that to you.
Good.
She has a very dark sense of humor, so I like
it.
Yeah. Well, didn't she send you to government school?
No. She was with me to get me out of there as soon as possible. So I love my mother. She's a great woman.
Oh wow! Insane.
She didn't cut off his foreskin.
No, yeah.
All right.
My foreskin just fell off.
Oh.
Some
people won't get this reference, but it's like putting the rubber band on the goat's testicles and having them fall off after a week.
Oh, no. Do you do that?
Yeah, if you raise goats, that's how you get rid of the males you don't want to reproduce.
Damn.
They just fall off because they're cut off from circulation.
Jesus.
Yeah.
Blue balls.
sorry, that's a sight you have to think about now.
But. Yeah. No, that physically hurts to think about.
Oh, speaking of goats, all the money we raised from selling chainmail at Porkfest is going to go to buying us a goat on Prickly Pear Plantation down here.
You live in Africa?
Somalia.
Somalia, yeah, okay. That makes sense. Congratulations. So you're getting a goat?
Yeah, we're going to get a dairy goat, okay. Or a couple.
One day we'll have an adobe hut.
I hope so. I would love. Actually, maybe I'll just build one in the backyard. I could do that.
Well, yeah, you'll be at a state where the United Nations will want to help you.
Yeah, help.
Oh, you can design your adobe hut with Photoshop.
Or in the corner.
There's a house near our house that has sheep in the front yard.
Yeah,
this is true.
Yeah, they're nice. They look really happy.
It's like downtown Portsmouth, and then all of a sudden, you see in someone's lawn where you see like a dog playing. It's a
two sheep.
Yeah, two sheep.
Yeah, was there a Bernie sign?
There were two sheep and like a goose.
Burn.
I don't know where they got the goose.
I think the goose just goes there to hang out.
Yeah, the goose is just friends with the sheep.
It's like they're really confused about what are actually pets in the U.S.
Oh my god. I love like odd animal couples where like weird animals are friends with each other.
Yeah.
So I'm like obsessed with that.
Like bunnies and rabbits?
Yeah.
I mean, bunnies and kitties? Puppies.
The same.
Oh yeah, the dog and the duck that were friends.
Well, tell us, how painstaking was it to make the chain mail? Like, how long did the process and how bad is it?
What do you mean, how bad is it?
He hates it.
Well, I mean, like, it must be grueling. It must be.
Oh, I thought you meant, like, how bad is the final product? I was like, oh, no, not that bad.
I'm sure it's amazing.
No, I mean, it took a little while to get used to, but once you get the hang of it, it still takes a long time, but, it's kind of relaxing. It's like, knitting almost or something. I sit outside and I, like, look over the fields and I just, you know.
I can imagine the autobiography of Joe Jarvis. I sat there and I looked out across the fields as a table of the chainmail.
Is it pure mithril?
Yes, it is, actually. I have put some blessings on it. I bought some rocks at a crystal store the other day. One for the magician's stone, one the sorcerer, or the, what's the other thing?
The unicorn stone.
Oh my god, I don't even know where I'm going.
Joe, do you think those rocks on the Silk Road?
I was going to say that, yeah.
What are the dimensions of the chain mail? Once you finish it, what are they going to be?
I don't know what it'll be when I finish. I don't know what it is right now, but there's a picture of it.
Oh, really? I'm going to have to see
that. I'll send you a picture. Oh, wait, no, I sent Remington a picture of me and my token, not of the,
Alright, well, getting Warcry's score is the first step towards managing and improving it. This is Charlie Sunstrom with the reaction lag. The most influential component of your credit score is not only your payment history, almost equally as important as the amount of credit accounts. Also impacting your score, but to a lesser degree, are the length of time you utilize your credit. The number of new accounts varies to various types of credit accounts.
I'm a senior, is it big enough credit score?
Instead of pushing what you mean, girls, but yeah, my hair's it's getting a little long, so I'm gonna get a haircut on Monday before I'm out of court.
People tell me I should see that in the video.
You've never seen any girls.
No, we will see it. No, I'm gonna sit there and I'm gonna watch it.
I'm concerned about when we're going to get down to Keene. My couple weeks there is really filling up.
You're going to Keene.
Well, if we need to interview some people for
Well, Joe, I set it up to the point where I don't think that we'll be, like, we won't be, like, at the interview. You won't have to get the interview because the way it's set up is that, have you ever seen those documentaries where you don't see the interviewer, but the person pops up? And then they answer those kind of things? But if you want it to be to where they see you, because then I have to have multiple camera shots.
I only have one camera.
Wait, well, are you saying for the whole thing, or just for the, just for those interviews?
Just for those interviews. Well, I thought it would be, you know, we would interview them, and we'd have to cut it together. But if you want it to be like, where they see you in two different shots, I can do that too. We can work on this.
No, that's fine.
Do you two want to talk about this documentary on there?
Yeah.
Well, I don't even think we have a name for it. Maybe we should,
Well, we have a name for it. It's Finding Freedom. It's Joe Jarvis.
Do you guys like that? Do you like that, Steven?
I like it. It's
be honest.
Cute.
I sent a picture of the graphic to Derek.
Because everyone's on a journey to find freedom. You know, it's like a craving that we're all trying to get at.
Yeah, that's true. But that's the series. Like, what's the actual... Remington didn't like my idea, which was freedom for granite. this is the granite state.
What?
No, it should be live free or die.
That's so boring.
I think finding freedom is pretty good.
Yeah, but that's like a
series name. So
I don't know what these different things you're trying to name are.
We got big plans.
You guys are talking about things that I don't know.
Joe and I don't have a Skype call on this, but
maybe we shouldn't discuss this.
Joe has such unreliable internet links. I feel bad for wanting to
be working pretty well now.
Yeah.
Where do I find the latest link for your quote? It's on your Facebook page.
Oh, I love that you just pulled that mic over there, Derek. Yeah,
you can see it on Facebook.
You just put that mic over there and you're like, I'm talking now over here.
Yeah.
You just find it. Mic.
Because we have four mics. We got four mics in here.
Yeah.
Is that a lead mineral?
It's a mineral, yeah. But we also have four microphones in our studio. I'm using like this really fancy mic for calling accountants.
So you want to do some topics or we can talk about the documentary? I'll just have to Joe. He's the charge.
I don't know what we're going to talk about with the documentary.
We have topics.
Why don't you say, like, what it is?
Yeah.
Why you're making it.
Yeah, explain that.
Yeah, like, why are you making it and what is it? Like, I would love to hear about that.
Okay.
All right, we got to make this up quick, aren't we?
Yeah, Randy, you interview Joe or something.
Okay.
Maybe I should rather interview you for practice. Since
I got a big fat ass. Bounce that butt. All right, shake it, Reddington.
I am shaking, just can't see it.
All right, shake it, Joe. I don't need you, Remy.
Oh, I'm shaking.
Joe, I'm going to grab your hips and shake them all around.
You don't know what I'm shaking to.
Oh, can't wait for Pork Fest. Oh, man, Pork Fest. All right, Remington. A pork vest? Yeah, it's a bacon vest.
Oh,
we don't wear it. Yeah, it's my pork vest for Pork Fest.
Uh-huh.
Well, we are back at home. We're going to talk to Joe Jarvis and myself. I'm going to interview myself. No, who's going to interview me about our upcoming documentary, Finding Freedom. It's our series for some nice, especially economic areas and free areas out of states, like outside of. Yeah, you understand what I'm saying. But yeah, Joe, go ahead.
Yeah, so we're starting with New Hampshire, with the Free State Project. And it's a unique one because most of these little startup societies, these little geolibras, we call them, economic free zones, most of them are a little bit more confined than that. So this is over an entire state. So we're focusing on Porkfest especially, as well as other areas. But Porkfest is going to be a big part of this documentary. Because it's sort of the culmination of the free state. You know, it's where everybody meets. So what we're going to be doing is seeing, kind of trying to figure out what the future of the free state has in hold. Because they recently triggered the move, but then there's also been this little shift, or what am I trying to say? Split based on banning Ian. In the past, they banned Chris Cantwell. So we're trying to figure out where are they going with this, and what's going to happen to the first state. What is going to bring for it? Is that pretty accurate?
That is very accurate, and I gave the idea to Joe. And for, was it you or me that gave the idea? I thought it was me.
I'm pretty sure I always come up with. No, I'm just kidding. I have no idea.
Well, one of us came up with the idea of getting the information about the these free places, in case anybody wanted to move there. And this isn't. I said this isn't just going to be like one sided. We want to get every point of view possible from this. We're talking to people who have way different perspectives on how things should be done, and we want to see what they think, and we want to hear their opinions. Because we want their voices to come out. We want untraditional voices. It's not going to be a PR campaign. It's untraditional voices.
I was actually saying that today. I haven't actually made up my mind about what I want the point of this documentary to be. And I'm not going to. We're going to go through this and make this documentary without trying to spin it in one direction or be like, oh, this is what you should believe. I think. That's what's going to be fun about it, and probably
it's going to be subjective.
Yeah, we're going to talk to a lot of people about what is happening, what they think should happen, what they envision their lives to be in the free state, and I think it'll be fun.
Mm-hmm. And in the future, we'll be going to many different places across the world.
Yeah,
just see how they are doing. But in this one specifically, since we're so close and we can gather so many more resources, we have a lot more connections here. We're going to get dive deep into it. And something that is very rarely done, journalism. We're going to get to the bottom of things, we're going to bring in the facts, and it'll be around 2 hours, hopefully to get the whole thing around 2 hours for everybody to enjoy. And it'll be, wait, is that crunch, Joe?
Yeah. Like Derek, most crime spray.
Yes.
All right, well, I look forward to the big showing in next year's Pork Fest.
Yeah, exactly right. Unless they ban it, if it doesn't come out favorably.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I was thinking to myself, they might ban it if they don't like it.
Well, that's one of the questions. It's how do we navigate this? If I'm a customer, how do I navigate this so that I don't, I just want to know what the rules are. I just want to know what the process is. Because, it is, I am a customer.
You know, we very well may come across some things that are highly favorable for the first state project. We don't know anything going. I make it sound difficult. We don't know going into this what we'll come out with. But we're going there, and we're going to come out with what we come out with, and that's how we're going to run with it.
I think the people in the free state project, their future is
increasing freedom and being more free than anyone else. That's what's happening. And the split that you're talking about, I think, is not very big of a deal.
Yeah, I don't think it really is either.
I think it's what's on the internet. I mean, I was just at a new movers party in Manchester where the doors to a private club, the Quill, are open to all. And people who, like, hate each other on the internet were all, you know, hanging out and drinking together and having food and, like, camaraderie, like, oh, good, I'm glad, yeah, we have new movers coming to the Free State Project, you know. It's good, like, even though we disagree about stuff, we can all move forward. Like, Steve and I are helping with Bean Fest Somalia, if you guys sign up for this. It's basically a protest event at Porkfest, so that people who actually love freedom and aren't afraid to voice their opinions about difficult issues can have a stage to do that.
And this documentary and the documentaries in the series are going to be against censorship. You are going to hear both sides. And I can't stress that enough, because, like I said, journalism, both sides. That is what has to be covered.
Yeah, what is both sides? I think you'll probably find that there's a few thousand sides to the story.
Well, both sides is a generalization. You shouldn't make generalizations, but all the sides, put it that way. All of the sides. Or everyone is going to be included, or representative for everyone in that sense.
Well, to the best of our ability.
We're going to work hard.
I'm sharing your shirtless photo, Joe.
Hell yeah. You're going to see plenty of that in the documentary, too. I think I'm going to wear something different. Like, I'm going to wear my kimono to Porkfest, and I'm going to wear some chainmail one day.
Just chainmail.
See, I will promise you that the first scene is just going to be me and Justin in the naked.
Do you have a kimono?
Yeah.
There's nudity in this documentary. Just
<it's>
nudity.
the whole hour is just me and Joe going at it.
It's not a documentary. It's porn. You're selling it as a documentary and all this stuff.
No,
that's the theme of the porn.
Serious documentary.
Yeah.
I would love a chainmail thong. Can I
knew that was going to come up somehow.
Yeah, I think that's the perfect thing for chainmail, really.
Yeah.
Because you can have a chain.
It actually needs protection.
How would that stay on, though?
It would be a thong.
How do thongs stay on?
It goes up your butthole.
Yeah.
Your butt crack.
I just don't see. I mean, there's still some like stretchiness there. I'm not seeing chainmail.
I think it's possible if you had, if it like clipped on.
No, I'm gonna have to design. I'm gonna have to make it onto your body. Well, that's the only option.
I think that's how it needs to be done. Yeah, because.
Hey, but you can't take it off after that. Like that's it. That's your life.
That's all right. You can wash.
So like a permanent chastity belt.
Yeah.
It's a shield against any unexpected elements coming at me. It'll just bounce right off. Any arrows that people shoot?
I'll be selling chainmail foreskin for anybody that needs it.
Chainmail foreskin, gross.
That's not going to keep it moist.
I can imagine how much that would hurt, too. But yes. It would be a great documentary, the best documentary.
That's cool. I'm glad that you're putting out the message of the free state and digging down into what's going on.
I think it's going to be interesting hearing what each, you know, person is going to envision their future to be. Because also, actually, I want to talk to Carla about the whole what's she head of now? The Liber
the Foundation for New Hampshire Independence.
Yeah, that's awesome. I love secession. I'm a big fan of secession.
It's independence.
Yeah. Isn't that
secession?
Independence is more different from secession. Like, for instance, you could have increasing independence while still being politically tied to other people.
Well, you don't want to be a vassal. You want to be an entire free state. Or lack thereof.
We'll get more freedom and more independence. Well, we're going to the break right now. We'll be right back.
Are you tired of governments around the world killing innocent people? Stop using their money. There is no alternative. Bitcoin is a
stateless, free market, non-political currency.
This is how we're going to move forward. I'm giving you a great idea.
Poor control of any state. I continue to use this device for perpetuating the killing. Stop doing it. You have an incredible
opportunity
to you now. Learn it.
You are the writer.
Get started with Bitcoin at
bitcoin.com. I have a new religion. Liberation. It melts political beliefs.
This is an economic photo. And research is a very political university.
Yeah, but that's like the whole square rectangle thing. Like, you know. Just because it's a political religion doesn't make all political religions.
Is capable of verbal speech, something no chimpanzee has ever been able to accomplish.
Here's something. Working vocal cords capable of seems to be going wrong in the
itself. Chimps have been observed using tools, but their tools are little more.
You guys need a mediator.
Even driving and preparing pancakes. Tasks we need for the stupidest, least educated humans.
Maybe I'll do you want to talk about it?
Yeah. Did you not get news updates about what's happening with the Warrior Network?
Very well,
you can sign up.
Because he is trying to create, and he is creating a very high quality production. And unless we're here in the studio an hour before the show starts, it takes a long time to set it all up.
It takes setting up, and I didn't want to go to the cocktail party tonight, and I was like, you know, on Flaming Freedom Days, I want to be in the studio and get things ready so that when it's time to do the show, I'm ready. And I hate when a show goes live, that feeling of, oh shit, I'm not ready.
So, yeah.
Yeah.
It sucks. And
yeah, I totally understand that.
For the last three episodes, I haven't been prepared. And I keep trying to be like, I need to be in studio. Today again, we're late, and it's frustrating for me. So,
and the thing that Derek really doesn't like hearing from me is I'm saying, let's start the show on time with less features.
Well, the problem with that approach is that if you do it the way we did it tonight, where you start with LRN and then you build off of that, the computer starts to lag. So every step that I take after that is slower than it would be if we did it before.
Because your computer is old and small.
It's not because it's old, it's just that I'm adding things for it to do. With every step,
its CPU is less powerful than it could be.
It's not.
It needs to be more.
The CPU is one of the most powerful on the market. It's not about that, it's about the order of operations.
Well, if you have more cores,
to get everything ready and then fire the gun when it's ready, that's when everything works the way it should.
And then my comeback to that is, you gotta start the show when it starts.
Well, I gotta be in studio and set up at the appropriate time.
So Steven, do you like to go out on Thursday nights? Is that part of the problem?
That's not the issue.
Everyone likes to create events on Thursday night. There's always great Liberty events.
Yeah.
The issue is
I reluctantly go along. I need to be in the studio.
The issue is that Derek hasn't yet said, I'm going home now. We have to be there by the time.
Yeah.
He hasn't been setting an alarm or anything like that. And then it gets too late. And I'm not thinking about it because
you got your sexy dress on.
Liberty-oriented audio stream. Derek tells me that I can't really help set it up.
No, that's not true. I asked you about saying you didn't know how.
Sorry, come back.
Yeah, we're coming back.
Anyway, I was just going to ask if you guys are doing Flaming Green on that Thursday during the Asia thing. Startup.
I thought that was Friday, Saturday, Sunday.
No, I'm probably getting confused.
Yeah, it's a Friday, Saturday, Sunday. Yeah,
okay.
The answer is yes. We're going to be doing it on Thursday. We do it every Thursday. And most especially, we do it at Porkfest. I can't wait.
Maybe I'll wear my chainmail.
If you haven't raffled it off already, I think that's...
No, because that's Thursday, and then the raffle will be Friday.
Oh, good. And your token party's Friday, too, right?
Exactly, so, yeah.
Okay, that works well.
Yeah, well, we're not going to let you in the door for it.
With only that.
You can wear a thong too, but that has to come off by the second hour.
I would like to see more nudity at Porkfest, though. That gets challenged every year.
Yeah.
And it's, I guess, I don't know.
Ooh, we're going to have to interview Nicole.
Yeah, of course.
Did she try to be topless in the whole thing?
Yeah.
She like kicked the whole thing off as far as I remember.
Just being topless? That is.
I know. It was hot. It was like 85 degrees or something.
She should have just said, no, I'm keeping my shirt off.
Hanging out. She could have done that. I think she said in the episode that they were pretty polite about asking. But still, it's annoying to be asked.
That's not polite.
Well, I don't know. And then there was another guy who wore a loincloth, and he was asked, and I wore a Speedo, and Jeff Eunice, one of the gay anarchists, was, I think, completely naked in the Atlas Society tent. And there was like a Stefan Kinsella thing going on with Jeffrey Tucker and whatnot. And like, they were just like, hey, we're trying to be stuffy libertarians over here. Put some clothes on.
Who, Jeffrey Tucker said that?
No. One of the organizers of the event, Matt Phillips, that year, he was the organizer. Now,
he's the president, right? The
president, yeah.
President.
I like that. I was annoyed that he asked me to put more clothes on than my Speedo.
I haven't actually met Matt in person yet.
Oh, yeah.
Well, you will. Yeah, he's pretty.
Yeah, he's got a good body. And entrepreneur type, so you know,
that's good.
He's a libertarian.
We're gonna give away
Yeah, but I don't have the questions.
Or Chase's
book. Give away Chase's book, but I don't have the questions ready. I can't even think about doing it right now. So we're gonna give it away in a different way.
Is Chase gonna be at Porkfest?
Chase,
yeah, of course.
He's not gonna be at Porkfest.
He's got a kid now.
It's a young child.
I'm confused. Is Chase what LB?
Hold on.
We're not doing that anymore.
Look behind us. I don't think you can see the screen. No gay, no bi, no straight.
I'm against that.
So then what does flaming freedom mean?
It's freedom for flaming people.
Right.
So, okay.
Look,
I'm confused.
This gay, bi, straight thing puts you into a box where now you're supposed to behave a certain way or else you're outside of the norm that you've been put into.
But I like being in a box.
Well, some people, I would dare say most people, are unique and they have different preferences and tastes. And if you put them in a box, they're not going to venture outside of it.
Oh my God. Sort of my life.
Right?
For other people. So, I'm like, can you just be a little adventurous?
Actually,
do you guys think about that? How if we didn't live in this sort of society, how much, how many STDs we'd have?
STDs?
No, sorry, I made a leap there. I meant how much action we have.
STD. There's all kinds of action going on all over the place. But there will probably be more STD solutions.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Like, there's PrEP. But STDs... What, Remington?
Well, sorry to get off the STDs tangent, but, I am full speed, I'm sorry. But...
But you're really bad at insulting.
What I was going to say is that boxes help people. I mean, without a box, I wouldn't know what I am, and I would hate myself more. I enjoy the box. I enjoy having something to lay claim to.
It's family. It's a bit of
kindness,
right?
And you will never, ever see me touch a woman, because that is gross. And I want something to describe that.
And Derek, have you just had sex with women?
Yeah.
No.
Several.
Yeah. Same here, a couple.
It was enjoyable. Look, they're people too. They're basically like 99.99% the same.
Except they have breasts and vaginas, and those things are gross.
Right. So like I was dancing with this guy once, and we were dancing very close and intimately, and he came up close to my ear and whispered like, hey, I really like this. I like being close to you, but I'm not gay.
I'm not so sure.
Look, that's not a thing. It's just not a thing. It's not that you're like gay.
I totally agree with that. It's like one time doesn't like change your entire life. Like if you did a gay thing, that doesn't make you gay. And I think that's a big problem in terms of boxes.
It's only an identity.
how you identify as yourself.
Well, there are a lot of also so-called straight guys who watch gay porn.
I don't think it's not really a good identity because it's a confused word. Yeah. Like, if you claim that you're this word, other people don't think the same thing that you do about that word. So to communicate it to them is mixing signals at best.
It's actually often where disagreements come from when you don't define your terms properly. You know, because a lot of people will say, oh, like, without a government, like, how would we do this? You know, and we'll say, oh, we'll organize. And they're like, well, that's the government. And it's like, no, like, we're defining government differently. We're saying that government involves the use of force. But if you define government as a voluntary group of people, then it's like, okay, well, yeah, then we're not against government. But, but that's not the definition.
Instead of using, like, these heady words, gay or straight, like, if I'm trying to be intimate with another guy, let's say, and I start, like, touching his arm or his chest or something, instead of being like, hey, are you gay? I'd be like, hey, how does this feel? Like, does this feel good?
I was bad at that in high school. I was like trying to like lay it all out there and like get answers, and it was like that was a horrible tactic.
There aren't answers. It's just like what's good in the moment. Like, well, like how can you connect with people and share what you both enjoy?
Or yeah. Especially if you're secluded and such, it's better to have that box. Because you can find more people with that box. If you can't, I mean, I would have got rejected so many more times if I didn't have that box.
What? Why? Where? What are you talking about?
Would have or what?
No, would have.
So that's
because I didn't approach the person because they said they were straight, and that is how I got it done. And
wait, what?
How does that feel?
How does that help me? It's because
you didn't approach them.
I think it's important if they say that they're straight to go for it anyway.
Yeah.
Because they don't, that straight word, it doesn't mean what you think it means in their head. Like, you have no idea what it actually means to them, and they don't either. Like,
means
they're just saying something.
They're afraid to express themselves in public.
Yeah, that's like just being, if you're in an intimate moment with them, who knows what you might want to do together? Like,
yeah.
It's not a real thing to say that you're straight. It's just a really bad way to communicate. It's a way to not communicate.
Certain women, I start thinking, I'm like, you know what? Like, I really like this person. And it doesn't generally get to the point where I'm thinking about them sexually, but there's definitely some attraction there. You can't, like, that, you know, fit into a box in that sense.
Well, there's affection, there's sexual attraction, there's... admiration. There's all kinds of ways that you can like a person, and it's different on like a one-to-one basis. So you never really know. Someone might think that they would never be like sexually attracted, or they want to be intimate with another person, but then they are because it's just they like this one person.
Right, especially if they've been raised to hate it. That's when I think a lot of the stoning of like gay teens and the Middle East is about. It's like, why are there so many guys to throw rocks at a kid who's gay? It's because they all feel a little bit gay themselves. They're trying to destroy that.
Yeah.
I don't like that, the way that you're thinking.
Well, I'm right. Don't deal with it.
Well, it's just, if you think that way, then you open yourself up to so many more situations that you shouldn't open yourself up to.
Why?
I think you're asserting something false, that you shouldn't, like, basically, what you're saying is, I filtered out everyone that's straight, so I never ended up interacting with anyone.
Wait a minute. I've never had sex with a woman, but that's my choice. You know, like, I'm. It's not like I'm saying I don't have sex with women because I am gay. It's because
I prefer going with other people's comfort zones. Like, if they define themselves with a comfort zone, I'm going to stick to that and say, okay, I'm going to stay out of this. I'm not going to make advantages on you because that is your comfort zone.
I like pushing people's comfort zones. They don't know what they want until I give it to them.
I'm a very shy and rapey person.
Well, so. You guys have been excellent. This was a great show. We'll see you next Thursday night on Flaming Freedom.
Good night.
Good night. Peace to you. And love to everyone. But especially Chase Rachel. We'll miss you at Cork Fest.
Hey, that was fun. Thanks, guys.
That was fun. Can't wait to see y'all in person.
It's just a week and a half away.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Exciting. I gotta get my toga.
Yeah. Get that ready, or
you bedazzled yours out. I gotta get some jewelry or something to go with mine, or a wreath on mine.
Yeah,
mine's gonna be on fire.
You guys want to walk around in our togas beforehand too?
Yeah, all day.
Yeah, to advertise so we can walk around like pretending that we're waxing poetic and talking.
Yeah, maybe we can gather on top of the hill and like we can all like sit around and have like a little Socratic sort of thing going on.
Drunk philosophy.
Yeah.
Can I dress like Rothbard?
That's not
ancient enough.
No. Aristotle, Plato, Socrates, those are all options, Remington.
Yeah. I'm very modest, though. How do I get around the modesty?
Oh my god, that's another box.
See, you're not modest. You're just making shit up now.
I don't like.
You know what? Like the party's not till Friday. We'll work on you Monday through Thursday.
Get out of your head and get into your body.
Oh my god, he's gonna have. Yeah. He's a Porkfest virgin. Think of how much he's gonna learn that week.
Oh my god.
Oh, goodness. Let's leave it there. It was fun to chat with you guys.
Out a lot.
Thanks for having me, guys. Have a good one.
You have a good night. See ya.
Sweet dreams.
Goodbye.